Ephesians chapter 4, 1 to 32. Jimmy Durante was one of the great entertainers of the 1930s and 1940s, was asked to partake of a show for the Second World War veterans, and because of his busy schedule, he told them he could only give a few minutes. But if they wouldn't mind, he would only go on and do a short monologue and then immediately leave. He was happy to do this for the performance. The director agreed to this. Yet an interesting thing happened during this performance. Jimmy Durante went on the stage and did his performance, and as you would expect, the veterans cheered and clapped loudly. But instead of coming off the stage, Jimmy Durante continued his performance. The veterans continued to show their appreciation. A few minutes became 15 minutes, then 20 minutes, and then 30 minutes, and finally Jimmy Durante left the stage. The director of the program stood him up and asked why he had extended his performance from a few minutes to 30 minutes. Jimmy Durante replied, "Well, I had to go, but I can show you the reason why I stayed. You can see it for yourself in the front row." And there in front of the front row, there were two veterans sitting. Each had lost an arm. One had lost his right arm, and the other one had lost his left arm. And together, they were able to clap excitingly and enthusiastically as much as they could. Now, the unity of these two veterans allowed them to respond to the performance in a way that was not due to some sort of external or mechanical means, but by the inner power of enthusiasm and in recognizing that for something to happen, there must be diversity in unity. This is Paul's point in the chapter. There is unity in the church. A unity which is not created by or maintained by external or mechanical means, but by the indwelling power of the Holy Spirit. Although we are oneness in unity, we are not the same. God has allowed for diversity in our midst. Section A, maintaining unity, Ephesians chapter 4, verses 1 to 6. Paul from his prison cell pleads and encourages us not only to live like the rest of the world, but rather that the believer is to have a lifestyle that sets him apart from the people, yet at the same time draws people to hear the wonderful message of the gospel. Artacides, a second century apologist for the Christian faith, wrote this to the Roman Emperor Hadrian about the believers of his day. And this is what he said. They love one another, they never fail to help widows, and they save orphans from those that would hurt them. And if they have something, they give it freely to the man that has nothing. And if they see a stranger, they take him home, and are happy as though he were a real brother. They don't consider themselves brothers in the usual sense, but brothers instead through the Spirit in God. See, Christians are not to live lives like others. Now, section 1, walking worthy of our calling. Ephesians chapter 4, verses 1 to 3. Alexander the Great was one of the greatest military generals who ever lived. With his vast army, he conquered almost the entire world. And one night during a campaign, he couldn't sleep, and he left his tent and he walked around the campground. And as he was walking around, he came across a soldier who was asleep on guard duty. And this was a very serious offense. The penalty for falling asleep on guard duty was in some cases being put to death. The commanding officer would sometimes pour kerosene over the soldier and light him. Now this particular soldier began to wake up as Alexander the Great approached him. Recognizing who was standing in front of him, the young man feared for his life. "Do you know what the penalty is for falling asleep on guard duty?" Alexander the Great asked the soldier. "Yes, sir," he responded with a quivering voice. "What is your name?" asked Alexander the Great. "Alexander, sir." Alexander the Great then repeated the phrase, "What is your name?" "My name is Alexander, sir," the soldier repeated. The third time and more loudly, Alexander said, "What is your name?" The third time, the soldier meekly replied, "My name is Alexander, sir." Alexander the Great then looked the young man straight in the eye and with intensity said, "Soldier, either change your name or change your conduct." Here in these verses, we have a great exhortation for us to walk a walk that is becoming of our Christian faith. If we are called by the name Christian, then let us walk worthy of that name and not hinder the aims of our profession. If you were a member of a political party, we would always endeavor to live lives in such a way that the party's strength and philosophies would be shown forth. So, by the use of five simple words, Paul uses here shows how that we might do the same for the cause of Christianity. And the first one is lowliness. The Christian character is marked by lowliness. The Greek word is better translated, used here as humility. Before Christianity, humility was not a virtue. In fact, the ancient world despised it. Humility was a dishonorable thing, for it conjured up a picture of a slave who did not seek to gain any recognition for themselves, who did not insist on their rights or any special consideration. Yet it's this character of Christ in whose footsteps we are called to walk. Because of this, humility has been pushed to the top of the Christian list of virtues. For such a life truly echoes Christ's life in the church and brings unity amongst the believers and members of the church. The former president, George Bush, told mourners at Ronald Reagan's funeral that the 40th US president taught him kindness, courage, and the power of humor during their years together in the White House. As his vice president for 8 years, I learned more from Ronald Reagan than anyone else I encountered in all my public life, Bush said with a voice breaking with emotion. I learned kindness. We all did. I learned principles. I learned about humor. Ronald Reagan was unfailingly courteous to the people around about him, thoughtful to the little guy, to the elevator operator, to the butler at the White House. Bush then revealed personal moments in President Reagan's life, such as a time when Reagan, as a hospital patient after the 1981 assassination attempt, was discovered wiping up spilt water from the floor. He was worried that his nurse would get into trouble. Bush said, "The good book says humility goes before honor, and our friend had both, and who could not cherish such a man?" The next is gentleness. A believer's way of life is marked by gentleness and sometimes translated as meekness. The Greek word that's used here describes an animal that has been trained and domesticated until it's completely under control. The word has a very positive connotation about it. In the ancient world, it was used to describe a person who was spiritually and morally strong, without being over-assertive, pushy or heavy-handed, of having every instinct and every passion under control. The Greeks believed that a person with such character traits could bear hardship and loss with tranquility. But the next is long-suffering. And someone once said that long-suffering is having the power to take revenge but never doing that. A spirit that refuses to retaliate. It may be described as the ability to deal quietly and courteously with awkward and difficult people. A good illustration is of a large dog. Puppies jump on the dog, they pull it, they bite it, they do all sorts of aggravating things to the dog, and yet the dog remains undisturbed. And this is the type of long-suffering that we are to have. The strength and ability to strike back, or even to become bitter, but refusing to do so. Long-suffering people do not consider their own feelings. What matters to them is the welfare of others. To be long-suffering is to be undisturbed by awkward and puppy people. The next is bearing one another in love. Here Paul is speaking of the practical outworking of long-suffering. It involves bearing one another's weaknesses, loving one another, though their faults may offend or displease us. Now it's said that when the British and the French were fighting in Canada in the 1750s, that Admiral Phipps, the commander of the British fleet, was told to anchor outside of Quebec. He was given orders to wait for the British landing force to arrive and then to support them when they attacked the city. Now, Phipps' navy arrived early, and as the admiral waited, he became annoyed by the statues of saints that adorned the towers of a nearby cathedral, and so he commanded his men to shoot at them with the ship's cannons. Now, no one knows how many rounds were fired or how many statues were knocked out, but when the landing forces arrived and the signal was given to attack, the admiral, was of no help. He had used up all his ammunition shooting at the saints. The word bearing in the Greek here literally means to hold up or to hold back. It carries the thought of restraining one's natural reactions towards those that you might consider difficult. Paul is telling us not to cease to love friends or members of the body of Christ just because their faults irritate us. Peace. Next, Paul says, in the bonds of peace, in verse 3, and peace spoken of here it, as if it was a rope that which can hold together a bundle of rods that are of different strengths or and different lengths that were normally not held together. And yet, when they are bound together, are stronger and thicker than any rod left by itself. Now, there's an old story told of two American soldiers in Vietnam that while eating lunch in the mess hall, they began to exchange harsh words, and then they got into a huge fight. But the sergeant was there, and he grabbed them both by the collars and dragged them outside and then pointed to the fields in front of them and said, "Gentlemen, the enemy is out there, not in here." See, Paul is aware that if we allow irritations and resentments to enter into our fellowship, we will soon sever the rope of peace that holds us together, and the weaker rods will become broken. The unity of the Spirit is both an individual and a community responsibility to maintain. We are to work at maintaining unity. Paul says, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit. Unity already exists in the church. No one has to create it. The barriers are broken down and we belong to the family of God. Paul points to the world and says these words, "The enemy is out there, not amongst the believers." And section 2, the basis of our unity, chapter 4 and verses 4 to 6. One for all and all for one. No doubt that you've heard this motto. It's best known as the motto of the character in the book, The Three Musketeers. That was written by the 19th century French author Alexandre Dumas and first published in 1844. And the story is all about Athos, Pathos, and Aramis, who stayed loyal one to another through all circumstances. Now, what is interesting about this motto, one for all and all for one, was it associated with the founding of the nation of Switzerland. In 1847, a newspaper campaign was launched under the slogan, "One for all and all for one," deliberately using it to invoke a sense of duty and solidarity and national unity in the population of this young nation. And in 1902, it was written in what was called the Constitution of Switzerland and has then been considered the unofficial motto of Switzerland. And Paul picks up the same theme and motto in this passage. He mentions the word one 7 times. He says that there is one body, one spirit, one hope, and so on. Paul tells us in this passage that we are one. The basis of our unity is captured in that motto, one for all for one. We stay loyal to one another through all the circumstances of life. The repetition of the number one has led Bible scholars to believe that the verses are part of an early Christian hymn or creed. Of the 7 times the numerical number one occurs, 3 of them make reference to the Trinity. And verse 4 says one Spirit. And verse 5 says one Lord, that is Jesus. And verse 6 says one God. Well, the other 4 relate to the Christian experience. Verse 4 says there is one body and one hope. And verse 5, one faith and one baptism. Therefore, to Paul, this unity amongst Christians is unthinkable because we all share in the following 7 basic treasures. First is one body. We are called the body of Christ because Since Christ's resurrection, we have become his hands, his feet, eyes, and ears, whereby that his work is continued. We are called the body of Christ. And because there is a what we call a coordinated oneness in us, which does not frustrate the head, who is Jesus Christ. Next, one spirit. This refers to the Holy Spirit, who is the life of the body or of the church. The Greek word for spirit is pneuma, and it means also spirit and breath. Unless there is breath, pneuma, in the natural body, the body is dead. So it is with the body of Christ, the church. Unless there is spirit, breath, in the body, it is dead. Next he says, one hope. All Christians are proceeding towards the same goal. Paul's thoughts here is actually going back to Ephesians chapter 1 in verses 13 and 14, where he talks about the guarantee of our inheritance, that we have received but a foretaste of God's promise for us that is still to come. And next he says, one Lord. And Paul here returns to his favorite thought that Jesus is Lord. The Greek word is kuros, and that we are his servants. The Greek word is doulos. So by these words, one Lord, Paul shows that we Christians are bound to Jesus with more than just lip service. We are bound together in him with the yoke that cannot be broken. We are his servants, totally and absolutely Christ's possession, and no evil force can break that bond. The next is one faith. It means that we are bound together in Christ by a common act of trust and commitment and complete surrender to Christ. Next is one baptism. This means that we are bound together in one act of public profession of faith. Water baptism. When a Roman soldier joined the Roman army, he made a public oath to be loyal to Caesar. Just so, a Christian by water baptism makes a public oath to be loyal to Christ. Next is one God and one Father of all. Now Paul uses the word Father to show that all Christians everywhere belong to the same family of God and share in the same conviction that God is our Father. With the words that God is above all, that is through all and in all, and whether it be the world of deity or politics or practical aspects of life, Paul proclaims that the Christians believe that we live in a God-created, God-controlled, God-sustained, God-filled world. God dwells in all things, and God working out all things in his purpose and through those things. Amen. Section B, Diversity in Unity, chapter 4, verses 7 to 16, beginning at verse 7. Paul points out here that although we are in oneness, in unity, we are not all the same. God has allowed diversity in our midst. Through the gracious favor of God, each of us has received a gift from Christ for the purpose of maintaining unity. Not one of us has been left out by God. Each of us has received a gift in the proportion to which God is pleased to give to us. One has a large measure and another has a smaller measure. Whatever the case, it is still given by Christ. Our thoughts cannot help but go back to the parable that Jesus told of the talents in Matthew's Gospel 25 and Luke's Gospel chapter 19. How each servant received a talent according to his ability, and each was entrusted to use them wisely. Unfortunately, we think of a talent as a coin, when in actual fact it was a weight of precious metal. One talent weighed 34 kilos. So a talent of gold or silver was a vast amount of money for which to be responsible. The gift that has been graciously given to us is of immense eternal value and is to be used wisely and effectively for the kingdom of God. The value of our gift is further heightened by the fact that the origin of the gift can be traced back to Christ. For Paul says, the measure of Christ's gift. Now how can we place the value on the measure of Christ's gift to us? We can't. Verse 8. To make his point about Christ being the giver of gifts, Paul quotes with a very significant difference from Psalm 68, verse 18. And the psalm describes the king's triumphant return from battle, entering into Jerusalem or to heaven through the city gates. He enters the holy city amongst the cheers and the adoration of the crowd, and then he ascends the steep road up to Mount Zion, and brings a band of captives, of prisoners in chains behind him, demonstrating his conquering power. Now these captives that Paul refers to are Christ's enemies, sin, death, and the powers of Satan, who have tried in vain to hold him in the grave. Christ triumphantly parades them through heaven, stripping them of their powers, and they are now submitting to him as King of Kings. Now the difference is that while the psalm speaks of the normal outcome of such an event, of the conqueror receiving gifts, Paul changes it to read that the conqueror gave gifts to men. Now these gifts are listed in 1 Corinthians chapter 12 verses 4 to 11 and verses 27 to 31, Romans chapter 12 verses 3 to 8, and here in Ephesians chapter 4 verse 11. And Paul tells us that it's through Christ's triumphant work at the cross that the gifts of the Holy Spirit operate, not through our own ability. Therefore, we have no right to exalt ourselves over other saints, for all the gifts that we have ultimately come from God. Now, verses 9 and 10. You'll notice that these verses are in parentheses. Paul wants to elaborate upon a point without losing his train of thought. And the point is about which he wishes to speak about is the supreme power of Christ over all things in heaven and in earth. He begins with verse 9, Christ's resurrection. At Christ's resurrection, he was exalted in glory above heaven, meaning that Christ was and still is and will always be exalted to the highest possible position of honor and power. Then the apostle says that Christ descended into the lower parts of the earth. Now the phrase is understood by scholars to refer to Christ's descent after his crucifixion to preach the gospel to those who had died before his coming and to pronounce judgment upon demonic powers, as recorded in 1 Peter chapter 3 verse 19 and chapter 4 verse 6. Paul brings this slight digression to a triumphant climax when he says that he, that's Christ, might fill all things. Now keeping in mind Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 23, scholars feel that the phrase is better translated something like this: so that his presence would fill and pervade every part of the universe. As the universe is seen as his divine property, Christ is able to supply the church with everything necessary to promote the gospel of the saints and the advancement of the gospel throughout all the world. And if humanity could colonize the moon and other planets, then it would also go there. Now verse 11. Paul now goes on to speak of specific gifts that Christ has given to the body of Christ, and they are apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. Now the gift of pastor and evangelist are two ministries that have remained constantly recognized in the church, probably because these two have remained most active in the work of sustaining the church through pastoral care and the advancement of the church by taking the gospel into the entire world through evangelism. With regard to the gift of prophet and apostle, though prominent in the early church, they lay dormant until the beginning of the 20th century when they came alive during the Pentecostal revival meeting in Azusa Street in 1900 and in the Welsh revival in 1905. It was not until the late 20th century, the early 21st century, that these two gifts found a much more wider acceptance both in the Pentecostal and in denominational churches. The two gifts are closely linked together, ensuring that the church is always built on the correct biblical foundations and teachings of Christ and the first century apostles and prophets, as well as the Old Testament prophets. Now the qualifications, the ministry of an apostle, are described in Romans chapter 15 verses 15 to 21, in 1 Corinthians chapter 9 verses 1 and 2, 2 Corinthians chapter 11 23 to 28, and 2 Corinthians 12 verses 10 to 13. And they are, in that they have seen the Lord. In today's setting, it means that they would have seen a vision of Jesus. Next is, proof of their labors have remained. And that is seen through the planting and growth of churches. And finally, by signs and wonders, that is the operation of the gifts of healings and miracles. Now the ministry of a prophet is recorded in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 27 to 30, and in 1 Corinthians chapter 14. And they are the edification and comfort and building up of the body of Christ and the teaching of the scriptures and prophetic ministry. As for the gift of teaching, though recognize that this gift found it difficult over the centuries to find its place and acceptance in the church. And this is because the two terms pastor and teacher in the Greek appear to be joined together, denoting one ministry. Paul in 1 Timothy instructs as a pastor that Timothy must teach. Now the difficulty of separating this gift from other gifts is further complicated in the fact that Jesus, in giving the Great Commission in Matthew's Gospel chapter 28, 19 and 20, tells us to go therefore and make disciples of all nations by teaching them the things that he has commanded them. Now in this case, the ministry of teaching is linked to the ministry of evangelism. And in Acts chapter 2, verse 42, we find that the ministry of teaching is linked to the ministry of an apostle. And finally, we find that the five leaders of the church of Antioch in Acts chapter 1, Acts chapter 13, verse 1, which include Paul and Barnabas, are described as prophets and teachers. Now, what can we understand from these passages? Though the ministry of a teacher can be separated from other gifts, it is necessary for the building up of the saints, part of all other ministries. If one holds the office of an apostle, prophet, pastor, or evangelist, and does not fulfill the ministry of teaching, then they are in effect not correctly fulfilling that office. Now let's look at verses 12 to 13. And even though Paul does make mention of the more important gifts in verse 11, his thoughts are not just on those gifts, but all gifts and their purpose to maintain unity in the body of Christ. And Paul states three purposes for the gifts, and found in verse 12. First, it is for the equipping of the saints. And the word equipping in the Greek, it's a medical word used for setting a broken limb. The idea is to restore the part of the body to a condition of fitness so that it might be able to properly discharge its duties in the body. So the first purpose of the fivefold gifts is to restore all members of the body of Christ to a position where they can function successfully in the body. And the second purpose is closely linked to the first, which is for the work of the ministry. And the word ministry in the Greek is the word diakona. And the idea behind the phrase is that of preparing each other for the service of Christ. The third purpose is for edifying the body of Christ. The thought here is of the body of Christ is built up and increased to a point where every member may adequately use their gift. Now Paul knows that this will eliminate rivalry and division amongst the body of Christ. Now Paul in verse 13 describes the goal of these three purposes. He says, till we all come into the unity of faith. Now, the process of moving from the purpose to the goal is described by Paul as being a journey. And the word come that's used here in the Greek is used to describe of a traveler arriving at a destination after a very long journey. The goal to which we are moving is maturity. And Paul describes this as the perfect man. And the word perfect in the Greek is telos, and it means adulthood. But the word statue supports this and speaks figuratively of maturity. Now this maturity is marked by unity of faith and the knowledge of the Son of God. The illustration painted here is that of a well-built male. Just not your average human being, but one who has a robust physical strength, filled with vibrant strength and without any defect. So spiritually, we are to become well-built Christians, vibrant with the knowledge of Christ, without disunity, no less ambition than this will do. Verses 14 to 16. Hence we have Paul's encouragement to grow up, telling us not to be children anymore. You know, children are unable to protect themselves and they are defenseless, not only against natural elements, but also susceptible to any deceitful teacher who would attempt to prey upon them and to lead them astray. Children are like ancient ships, Paul says. They have no defense against winds. They cannot tack in and out of storms and would only be carried along and tossed to and fro by all the winds. So children, the immature believers, is tossed to and fro in the winds of deceit. There are two sharp contrasts found in verse 15. The first is the contrast of false teachers and we, the body of Christ, who speak the truth in love, meaning that we cherish truth, that we are to maintain it in love, meaning that we are to be utterly genuine, sincere, and honest in all that we teach. You know, sodium is an extremely active element that is found naturally only in a combined force. It always links itself to another element. And chlorine, on the other hand, is a poisonous gas which gives bleach its offensive odor. Now, when sodium and chlorine are combined together, the result is sodium chloride, what we call common table salt. Now, the substance we use to preserve meat and to bring out its flavor. Love and truth can be likened to sodium and chlorine. Love without truth is flighty, sometimes blind, and like sodium, on its own is in danger of combining with false teaching. On the other hand, truth by itself can be offensive and sometimes even poisonous, spoken without love. It can turn people away from the gospel. When truth and love are combined in an individual church or an individual, then we have what Jesus has called the salt of the earth, where we're able to preserve and to bring out the beauty of our faith. Now the second contrast is between immature and mature. The thought is that we are to keep an even balance between truth and love, so the body of Christ grows in even proportion to the head, who is Christ. An imbalance of either may lead to a deformity in the body of Christ. Paul urges us not to let our actions, whether either conscious or subconscious, mar or deform the beauty of the body of Christ. As there is a communion between the members of the natural body for growth, so there should be a communion between the members of the body of Christ for growth. This communion should consist of mutual love. There's a story told of a man who couldn't swim, and he went fishing with his friend, and after a while he caught a really big fish, and he got so excited about the catch that he leant right over the side of the boat to pull it in, and he fell into the water. Coming up, he yelled out, "Help, help, save me, help, help, save me." Now his friend reached out and was going to grab him by the hair and to pull him into the boat, and when he did, the man's toupee came off and he slipped back into the water. He again came up yelling, "Help, help, save me." This time, he grabbed hold of the man's arm and pulled as hard as he could, and the man's arm came off. It was an artificial arm. The man continued to kick and splash around, and his friend finally reached out and grabbed his leg and pulled as hard as he could, and it also came off. It was a wooden leg. And as the man continued to splash around calling for help, his friend, in disgust, stood up in the boat and said these words, "How can I help you if you won't stick together?" You see, Paul's point in verses 14 to 16 is that we cannot grow up in Christ and fulfill our part in the body of Christ unless we stick together. Thus, Paul in verse 16 tells us that we are to be joined and knitted together. The words joined and knit are building terms of clamping and bonding and building together by using clamps and cement. Paul literally means that we are to be cemented together in the utmost firmness. And in the context, it means that each one of us find our true place and function in relationship to Christ. As all parts of the building find their right relationship to the architect's design, and in our case, the designer is God. To further stress his point, Paul moves from building terms to anatomy terms and describes the church as a body, with joints such as legs, arms, fingers and toes and so on, that work effectively together to give the body strength and the ability to grow. This takes place when everyone does their share. That is, when everyone, using their measure or their gift or capacity or function, to effectively work together to support and to create growth in the local church. Section C, personal standards. Ephesians chapter 4, verses 17 to 32. Section 1, putting off the old man and putting on the new man. Chapter 4, verses 17 to 24. Beginning at verses 17 to 19. There's a story told of Marie Antoinette before she was the Queen of France, was the Archduchess of Austria. In 1767, she was engaged to the son of the French King Louis V, who descended as Louis XVI to the throne on the death of his father in May 1774. Now, Marie Antoinette was officially handed over to her French bearers on the 7th of May 1770 on an island along the Rhine River near the town of Kiel, and married on the 16th of May 1770. And the story goes that before Marie Antoinette could enter the Kingdom of France, she had to remove all her clothes, jewelry, and personal belongings in order to be accepted into the new French kingdom. Everything she had of the old Kingdom of Austria had to be totally disregarded, and Marie Antoinette had to put on everything that was French. She was no longer Austrian, she was French, and as such, she could enjoy all the riches of her new kingdom. Now, Ephesus was one of the most destitute and evil cities in Asia Minor. It served as a religious center for a multitude of temples and idols. The worship of Ephesus focused particularly on the goddess Diana or Artemis in the Greek, often represented by a multi-breasted woman. Diana was worshipped as a sex god. Scores of eunuchs and priestesses and temple prostitutes and singers and dancers led the people in their worship, which was nothing more than one great orgy. One writer said that the worship was at that time a type of hysteria, where the people, with shouts and music, worked themselves up in such a frenzy of shameless sexual activities. Heraclitus, a Greek philosopher from Ephesus in the 5th century before Christ, often criticized the moral standards of his own city. The cesspool of immorality had affected every member of society. This description of the city of Ephesus could quite easily be applied to any city in the 21st century. Paul instructs the church at Ephesus that as heirs of the promise, just as Marie Antoinette had to disregard the Kingdom of Austria if she was to enjoy the riches of France, so too Christians are to remove and completely disregard our former manner of life and not to imitate our old environment. And this is necessary if we are to enjoy the riches in Christ. Paul says this must be so for a number of reasons. The first is that the old life produces what we call a futility of mind. And the word futility describes the state of those who return to their former life as returning to a long series of mocked expectations, where they are pursuing but never achieving, blossoming but never producing fruit, where their life seems to be like a river trying to fill up a bottomless sea. The second reason is because of blindness of heart, and the word blindness in the Greek comes from a word that means harder than stone or harder than marble. Later it came to have a certain medical use for chalk stone or calcification, which can form in the joints and completely paralyze the joints. The word evolved to mean a loss of power or sensation. Today, however, it's commonly used to describe cavities or cavities in a bone or in other hard material. Paul is reminding us that the old life brought blindness to our hearts and our conscience, had become so paralyzed that it was unable to convict us of our wrongdoing. And that this blindness has brought us to a place where we had lost all moral sensitivity. As if to emphasize our insensitivity in our life, Paul uses two terrible Greek words to describe our old ways. The first is lasciviousness, which actually means lewdness, shameful wantfulness, or debauchery. It describes a person who does not care how much their sin shocks public opinion, so long as they can gratify their own desires. The fact that Paul links it with the word uncleanness implies shameless disregard of others was in the area of sexual misconduct. The next word that Paul uses is greediness, which describes possessing a passion to possess something without regard to others. Now verses 20 to 21, Paul goes on to tell us that these things we did not learn in the school of Christ, where we were diligent students. Paul's point is that as diligent students of the words of Christ, we not only learn doctrine, but we learned that as disciples of Christ, we cannot live in darkness and in sin. Paul presses home this point by the phrase, as the truth is in Jesus, which brings to light two things. First, that we are now citizens of a community or kingdom that is in accordance with truth. And secondly, that we are in fellowship with Jesus Christ. Such combinations should not be spoiled by reckless sin. Verses 22 to 24. Paul is dealing with our part of sanctification. Just as Marie Antoinette was instructed and mentored by her French governess to conform to her new position as being French and no longer doing the things that characterized the Archduchess of Austria, so too the Apostle Paul instructs us and mentors us to no longer practice those things that characterized us before we were saved. He describes the old life before Christ as something that grows corrupt. The imagery that Paul seems to be using here is that of a person who is washed clean and then goes and puts on a diseased and contaminated clothing that corrupts and eventually destroys the flesh of the wearer and they die. For the wearer to escape such death, they must get rid of the old clothing and replace it with a clean, hygienic clothing. Such transformation begins in the inner intellectual transformation. Begins with an inner intellectual transformation. Paul says, be renewed in the spirit of your mind. Now, no one lives in an intellectual vacuum. We are either feeding our minds with things that destroy us or things that give us life. You see, the mind never thinks. The verse seems to link back to what Paul has said in verse 20, that we must continue as diligent students in the school of Christ through the study of the Word of God, the Bible. Without the Word of God, we live spiritually and intellectually deficient lives. Paul is mentoring us not to make our conscience or intellect dead to the instructions of the Word of God. Therefore, as Marie Antoinette put off the realm of the Austrian Empire and put on the realm of the French kingdom, let us put off the old, paralyzed, callous, insensitive ways of the kingdom of Satan and sin, as if it's some sort of contaminated clothing, and put on the new man who is created in the sensitivity of Christ and his kingdom. Of course, such things can only be done by the power of the Holy Spirit working in our lives. Section 2, don't give the devil a foothold. Chapter 4, verses 25 to 32. Here, Paul speaks quite specifically of sins that we must put off. These sins he sees as unsightly, filthy rags that give Satan a foothold in our lives. Yet Paul does not leave us naked, for he tells us specifically what must replace these unsightly rags. He begins with lying, verse 25. Paul begins with lying and falsehood, The idea behind the word is a deliberate distortion of truth for the purpose of deceiving someone for personal gain. Now, this is to be replaced by open-hearted truthfulness amongst believers. See, lying is not only wrong because it causes trouble, friction, and disunity and sadness in the church, but also because it makes light of the intrinsic excellence and beauty of truth. The next is anger or wrath, verse 26. A story is told of a little boy that one morning got into a fight with his older brother, and he was somewhat outmatched and took quite a beating. It was his pride, however, that was suffered the most. The whole experience left him feeling very bitter, and he refused to talk to his older brother all day. Bedtime came, and his mother, very much wanting the two young boys to make up, said to the younger one, "Don't you think that you should forgive your brother before you go to sleep? Remember, the Bible says, don't let the sun go down on your wrath." And the youngster looked perplexed and thought for a few moments and then blurted out these words, "But mummy, how can I keep the sun from going down?" Aristotle once said, "Anyone can become angry, that's easy. But to be angry with the right person, to the right degree, at the right time, for the right purpose, and in the right way, that's not easy." The anger of which Paul speaks about in verse 26 is righteous anger. That is directed against Satan and the evil actions of people who cause pain and suffering to other people. Yet he gives us a warning here that we should not let the sun go down on our wrath. Wrath is anger turned to bitterness and malice. Paul knows if we allow anger to be harbored and brooded in us and our sleep, that it will awaken in the morning as a monster of wrath, devouring all with bitterness and anger. Now, Bible scholars tell us that the verse is written in the present tense and is better translated something like this: "I command you to be continually angry as needed, and to continually not sin in your anger." Now, why does God command us to be continually angry? Because anger, that is righteous anger, when properly used, is a tool that God can use not only to cause us to rise up against injustice, but to accomplish his purpose. Once righteous anger dies in the church, then the powers of Satan are free to reign in the lives of men and women. Now, Edward Burke, an Irish statesman, author, and political theorist, philosopher, who lived between 1729 and 1797, supported the American Revolution and later opposed the French Revolution, said these famous words, "All that is necessary for the triumph of evil is that good men do nothing." The next is theft. Theft was, and is today, the most common of all crimes. In the ancient cities of Greece and Rome, most thefts occurred in the public baths. A thief would steal the belongings of those that were bathing at that time. Paul not only instructs us to stop stealing, but to earn our own money, to meet our own needs, and also, if we have any left over, to share it with those who are without. The reference to our own hands is placing emphasis on that which we use for corrupt actions now must be given over to actions of honesty and care for others. The next is foul speech of verse 29. The word corrupt in the Greek word here means rotten and worthless. It actually speaks of speech that's like bad fruit, rotten and worthless. Not only does it spread rottenness, but it causes people to think of worthless things. Robert E. Lee, the commander of the Confederate Army in the American Civil War, was asked what he thought of General Joe Johnson, a fellow officer in the Confederate Army. Now, Lee rated him as being very satisfactory and made some glowing comments about the man. Now, the person who asked the question seemed perplexed. Generally said, "I guess you don't know what he's been saying about you." "I do know," answered Lee. "But I was asked my opinion of him, not his opinion of me." Paul tells us that our speech should give edification. And the Greek word here is to edify. It means to build up the matter at hand. In other words, we should aim to add something good to the situation at hand. Coupled with the word grace, Paul is saying that such things that we add should bring a special strength from God himself. The next one is, do not grieve the Holy Spirit, in verse 30. Now in this verse, we are reminded that the Holy Spirit is a person, that he's a third member of the Trinity, and like any other person, he can be grieved. By grieved, Paul is saying that we are not to undertake any action in our lives, whether careless or intentional, that will insult, sadden, or disappoint the Holy Spirit. For Paul sees that such actions often deny the Holy Spirit's indwelling and sanctifying presence in our being. Paul reminds us that it is the Holy Spirit who's placed his seal upon us in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 13. A seal that shows that we are undeniably God's possession and destined to heaven. And just as a woman wears on her left hand an engagement ring as a promise of her love and the love of a fiancé, so we bear a seal of God's great love for us and for all humanity. And in the same manner that no young future bride would want to disappoint her husband, nor should any of our actions disappoint or grieve the Holy Spirit. Now, six sins replaced by two virtues, verses 31 to 32. Paul now tells us the way to avoid grieving the Holy Spirit is by not allowing the following things to operate in our lives. The first thing that Paul tells us to do is to let go of bitterness. We're to put this out of our lives. Bitterness in the Greek is a terrible word. It actually describes someone whose tongue is as sharp as a razor. One who is so resentful that they refuse reconciliation. You know, a little grudge can create a huge gap in human relationships. The Philippines Daily Express newspaper reported of a couple in England who lived together as silent partners for 12 years. The wife was now filing for divorce. For 12 extraordinary years, they had lived their lives so that they would never meet each other. Their lawyer, Simon King, who was handling the case, said this: when one would come into the house, the other would leave. And when they did communicate, they would leave each other notes. Now, they had lived happily together for the first 18 years of their marriage and raised a son. For the last 12 years, however, they did not speak to each other. Ironically, neither one could remember what the hassle had been all about. No doubt the actions of the parents would have deeply grieved the son who had previously witnessed a happy marriage. Now, bitterness is like a seed that, when allowed to fester, grows like an untreated wound that cannot be healed, and reconciliation with the rest of the body is impossible, and that limb must be cut off. Many church splits start off with something that no one can remember, and sadly, the only answer is for the brethren to separate. How this must deeply grieve the Holy Spirit. And next, we are to let go of wrath and anger. The two words describe here of a sudden, tumultuous outburst of anger and maintain it. The Greek word wrath here describes an anger that of a quick burst, which quickly bursts on the scene like fire in straw that soon dies down. And anger describes a long-term anger. So the two together show a quick flare-up of anger that is not easily put down. The list goes on that we are to put away quarreling, which is clamor, and the words describes an angry person who wants everyone to hear their grievance. Evil speaking is not to be part of our lives, which in the Greek is blasphemy, a word used for slandering God, and here it means to slander men and women who are made in the image of God. And finally, we are to put away malice, which means bad feeling that sets out to and delights in inflicting injury on another. Now, Paul encourages us to lay aside such evils and instead implement the principles of love. The Carnegie Foundation discovered that to be successful on a job, relationship skills are more important than knowledge. Its research found that only 15% of a person's success is determined by job knowledge and technical skills. 85% is determined by the individual's attitude and ability to relate to other people. The scriptures command us to be kind one to another, tender-hearted, loving one another, even as God in Christ forgave you. To be tender-hearted is to be merciful in our actions, quick in compassion and in pity to each other. While forgiving one another in love requires that we freely and generously and wholeheartedly and spontaneously eagerly treat the other with the same graces and generosity of heart and action with which God has treated us. By doing these two things, we will walk worthy of our high calling, as seen in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1. At the funeral of the President Ronald Reagan, Michael Deaver, an aide and close friend of his, said of this of the President Reagan, "He respected people and treated everyone the same, whether they were a king or a butler." Now this eulogy should be spoken over the lives of all believers. Now we have the conclusion. You know, sunflowers are one of the most amazing flowers God has created. It literally follows the sun. Watching one flower follow the sun is pleasant, but watching hundreds in absolute unity following the sun is quite incredible. Sunflowers continue to track the sun's direction long after sunset. Through 360 degrees, they ensure that they're always orientated in the direction of the sun. Their unity is totally dependent upon one thing, that is their relationship with the sun. And the same is with the believer. Our unity is totally dependent upon one thing, and that is following the Son of God 24 hours a day, every day of our lives. Amen. God bless you.